Welcome. Have you ever wondered what is meant by the term seismic waves? In this lecture, I will explain how seismic energy is generated at the hypocenter of an earthquake and how different waves of energy travel through the Earth. Three types of seismic energy are generated by an earthquake, and they radiate from the hypocenter to the surface of the Earth. These three waves have their own characteristics, and they travel at different velocities through the Earth. The three types are compressional waves, also called P waves, shear waves, also called S waves, and surface waves. P waves, or compressional waves, are the fastest seismic waves that travel through the Earth, and thus they are also the first ones that are recorded as a seismic station. They are characterized by particle motion in the same direction as the direction of propagation of the wave. You could compare this to the propagation of sound through the air and waves in a stretched spring. S waves, or shear waves, travel slower through the Earth than compressional waves. They are characterized by particle motion in a direction perpendicular to the propagation direction of the seismic waves. The S waves can be compared to light waves and water waves. The velocities at which these seismic waves travel depend on the rocks they travel through. Some rock types exhibit high velocities, while other rock types exhibit lower velocities. P and S waves are body waves that travel through the Earth. The third type of seismic wave are surface waves that travel only along the surface of the Earth. The two important surface waves are the Rayleigh wave and the Love wave. They display more complex particle motion directions, both compression in multiple directions, but also rotation of the particle motion. Because of its complex particle motion patterns and because of their typically very large amplitudes, these surface waves are the most destructive waves that cause most of the damage to buildings and structures at the surface of the Earth. The arrival of these waves generated by an earthquake are recorded by a seismogram on a seismograph. Typically, the P waves arrive first because they travel the fastest, followed by the S waves and then the slowest surface waves. But these surface waves have by far the largest amplitude. Seismic waves that are formed at the earthquake epicenter have a certain wave amplitude, and the amplitude reduces as the wave travels away from the earthquake location. The further away from the earthquake location, the smaller the amplitude is, like the amplitude of sound that reduces further away from the source. This means that wave amplitude at the surface of the Earth is in general largest, as close as possible to the earthquake epicenter. And the wave amplitude and thus damage becomes smaller further and further away from the earthquake location. Therefore, the depth of an earthquake can also play an important role when considering the damage the earthquake might do. Deep earthquakes do not necessarily have any more large amplitudes at the surface of the Earth, while shallow, relatively small earthquakes can still have relatively large amplitudes at the Earth's surface. And this is of importance in the Groningen situation, where compaction-related seismicity due to gas production occurs at relatively shallow levels in the subsurface of the Earth. The Groningen gas reservoirs are situated at depths of around 3 kilometers. And these cause relatively more damage to the structures at the surface of the Earth compared to similar-sized deeper events. And in specific circumstances, there may be amplification of the waves in the shallowest layers of the Earth, even if we are far away from the epicenter. Amplification means that the wave amplitude is increasing again. And this can particularly occur in soft sediments and soils, and this is due to the specific structure and mineral and fluid content of the material. So in this lecture, we looked at the type of seismic waves generated by an earthquake and how its energy propagates away from the earthquake location. In the next lecture, we'll explain how earthquake magnitudes are being defined and determined for engineering design.